Starting the 8th seminar of the seminar series organized by the Bank of Ceylon under the Nanajaya program. First of all, I must be thankful for the Bank of Ceylon for giving me this great opportunity. We will start today's discussion. Today's discussion is focused on the 9th lesson of the syllabus, International Trade. So we will start the discussion. Right, we will move on to the first question. What do you mean by absolute advantages principle? What are the determinants of absolute advantages? So, in this lesson, the 9th lesson, we are developing a theoretical basis to enter into international trade for a country. We are rationalizing, or we are trying to prove why countries should enter into international trade without trying to produce all the goods and services a country wanted within their country itself. So we use two theories to prove international trade. One is the absolute advantages principle, the other one is the comparative advantages principle. So this first question is focused on the absolute advantages principle. What do we mean by the absolute advantages principle? If a certain country can produce a certain product at a lower unit cost when compared with another country, or else if a certain country can produce a certain product at a higher input productivity when compared with the other country, then that country is said to have the absolute advantages on that respective product. If a certain country can produce a certain product at a lower unit cost when compared with another country, or at a higher input productivity when compared with another country, then that country is said to have the absolute advantages on that respective product. So, we will see the given answer. When one country can produce a certain product at a lower unit cost than another country, or at a higher productivity than another country, then that country is said to have absolute advantages on that respective product. A country should specialize in the product in which they have absolute advantages and export the surplus in order to engage in the international trade. So the rest part of the question is, what are the determinants of absolute advantages? We will see. So there are a few determinants of absolute advantages. Resource endowment of a country, the goodwill held by a country, the historical factors, specific climate are the factors which create the absolute advantages for a country. Right. So this is how we can answer this question. We can move on to the next question. Question number 2. Given below shows the production possibility of Switzerland and Germany, where each country possesses 100 labor units. Production possibility of 100 labor units. So when this kind of a table is given, you need to carefully see whether this table is talking about the input productivity or is the cost of production. So if it is showing the input productivity, we identify that as an output table as well. So here in this table, what do they say? Production possibility of 100 labor units. What does it mean? The amount of watches, the number of televisions each country can produce by using 100 labor hours are given here. The number of watches and then the number of televisions this country can produce by using 100 labor hours are given here. So therefore, when it comes to the output table, right? An output table is always giving us some number of units of output of some two products, by which can be produced by using one input unit or by given number of input units. So here, this table gives us the production possibility of 100 labor units. Switzerland can produce 600 watches, whereas they can produce 400 televisions by using this 100 labor units. Also, German can produce 1000 watches or else 200 televisions by using 100 labor units. So, we will move on to the question. There are three sections. The first question is to draw the production possibilities curve of each country in two different diagrams. We are supposed to draw the production possibility of the production possibility curves of the two economies using two diagrams. So we will go back to the production possibilities schedule they have given us. Switzerland can produce 600 watches and 400 televisions. Accordingly, we have to get a certain scale to draw the graph. And then German can produce either 1,000 watches or else 200 televisions by using these 100 labor units. So we will draw the production possibilities curve for the two countries. And watches. So if the first country, Switzerland, uses all their resources to produce watches, if Switzerland uses all their resources to produce watches, they can produce 600 watches. Or else if they use all their resources to produce televisions, they can produce 400 televisions. So therefore, the production possibility curve of Switzerland should be 600 watches can be produced if they use all their resources to produce watches. And then they can produce 400 televisions if they allocate all their resources to produce televisions. So by joining these two points, we can draw the production possibilities curve of Switzerland. We can draw the production possibilities curve of Switzerland. And then we are supposed to draw the production possibilities curve for the other country as well, which is German. German can produce either 1,000 watches or else 200 televisions by using this available 100 labor units to the country. So we will draw the production possibilities curve for German as well. So if they allocated all their resources to produce watches, they can produce 1,000 watches. But if they allocated all their resources to produce televisions, they can produce 200 televisions. So by joining these two points, we can draw the production possibilities curve of the other country, which is German. Right? Both of these two production possibilities curves should be straight line production possibilities curves. So we drew the production possibilities curve for German and then we drew the production possibilities curve for Switzerland as well. Right. We will see the next question. The part B, which country should specialize in each product? Which country should specialize in each product? So we will go back to the production table they've given us. So they have given us the production possibility of 100 labor hours. When Switzerland can produce 600 watches by using these 100 labor hours, German can produce 1000 watches. So therefore, absolute advantages for producing watches is therefore German, as German is the country which can produce the highest number of watches by using these 100 labor hours. And then German has the absolute advantages in producing watches because German can produce the highest number of watches by using the available 100 labor hours when compared with the other country, Switzerland. And then when 400 televisions are produced by Switzerland by using these 100 labor hours, the other country, German, can produce only 200 televisions by using this 100 labor units. Therefore, Switzerland has the absolute advantages in producing televisions, right? German has absolute advantages in producing watches, whereas Switzerland has absolute advantages in producing televisions. Therefore, German should specialize in producing watches, whereas Switzerland should specialize in producing televisions. That is how we should answer the part B. The part B is which country should specialize in each product. So we identified that German should specialize in producing watches and German should, we will go back to the table. As we already identified, German should specialize in producing watches and Switzerland should specialize in producing televisions. We will go for part C of the question. Part C, if one television is exchanged with four watches, and if 100 televisions are exchanged, draw the consumption possibilities curve for the two countries. If one television is exchanged for four watches, and if 100 televisions are exchanged, right, draw the consumption possibilities curve for the two countries. PVC, we are supposed to draw the consumption possibilities curve for the two countries. For that, they have given us the exchanging ratio, one television for four watches, right, and 100 televisions are exchanged. So the production possibilities model or the schedule is here. So based on this, we identified that Germany is specializing in producing watches and Switzerland is specialized in producing televisions, right? As Switzerland is specialized in producing televisions, right, what do we mean by specializing in producing televisions? Switzerland allocate all the labor hours they have on producing the product in which they are specializing. We identified that Switzerland is specialized on producing televisions now. Therefore, Switzerland will allocate all the 100 labor hours they have on producing televisions and they don't produce any watches. Switzerland allocate all the 100 labor hours on producing televisions, therefore they can produce 400 televisions, and Switzerland does not produce any watches. And afterwards, in that question it said, right, that they are exchanging 400 televisions and the ratio between the two products to exchange is one television for four watches. So if they are exchanging one television for four watches, right, if they are exchanging one television for four watches, for 100 televisions, they should exchange 400 watches. So Switzerland produced 400 televisions, and from that, if they export 100 televisions to the other country, they will be able to consume only 300 televisions. Why is it? Singapore produced 400 televisions, from that 400 televisions Singapore produced, they export 300 to, they export 100 to the other country. Therefore, Switzerland can consume only 300 televisions. But in return to the 100 televisions they exported to the other country, in return to the 100 televisions they exported to the other country, they are getting 400 vouchers as the ratio between the two products to exchange is one television to 4 vouchers. So for 100 televisions, they should be exchanging 400 vouchers. So therefore, now Switzerland is consuming 400 vouchers and then 300 televisions. This is their current consumption point. After specializing in producing televisions, Switzerland is producing 400 televisions and nothing from vouchers. So therefore, by joining these two points, we can get the consumption possibilities curve of Switzerland. Here CPC is standing for the consumption possibilities curve. CPC is standing for the consumption possibilities curve. How did we draw the consumption possibilities curve for Switzerland? We specialized in the product in which the country is having absolute advantages. Specializing means what? That country allocates all their resources on that respective product in which they are having the absolute advantages. So Switzerland had absolute advantages in producing televisions, so they allocated all their resources on producing televisions. So Switzerland could produce 400 televisions. From these 400 televisions Switzerland is producing, they are now exporting 100 televisions to the other country, Germany. So from Germany, they are getting 400 vouchers on behalf of these 100 televisions, as the exchanging ratio is 1 television is to 4 vouchers. So therefore, now Switzerland is receiving 400 vouchers from the other country. So through that, Switzerland will be able to consume 300 televisions and then 400 vouchers. That consumption point is here. So we joined these two consumption points to get the consumption possibilities curve of Switzerland. And now we will draw the consumption possibilities curve for German as well. As we discussed previously, German should specialize in producing vouchers, right? German should specialize in producing vouchers. So specializing in producing vouchers means what? German is now producing 1,000 vouchers, and they don't produce anything from the televisions. So after specializing in one product, if they did not go for trade, right? Now German specialized in producing vouchers and they produce 1,000 vouchers, no? So afterwards, if they did not go for trade, only thing what they can consume is what they produced. So they produced 1,000 vouchers and that is what they can consume. Therefore, this 1,000 vouchers is a production point for German in one hand, and on the other hand, it is a consumption point for German as well. And now German is offering 400 vouchers on behalf of the 100 televisions they are getting from the other country, Switzerland. So German produced 1,000 vouchers, and from that they export 400 to the other country, Switzerland. Therefore they only can consume 600 vouchers now. And they are getting 100 televisions from the other country for the 400 vouchers they are exporting to the other country. As a result, the consumption level of Germany is standing at 100 televisions and 600 vouchers. How is it? German produced 1,000 vouchers altogether. And from the 1,000 vouchers they produced, they exported 400 to the other country, Switzerland. And from Switzerland, they got 100 televisions from the other country. So from the 100 televisions they got from the other country, as they will be able to consume 100 televisions and 600 vouchers. So their consumption point is standing at this point. So by joining these two consumption points, we can draw the consumption possibilities curve for German as well. So you can see that the consumption possibilities curves of the two countries are lying on the top of the production possibilities curve. Actually, this is what we identify as the gains from exchange through the international trade. A country will be able to consume being at a point outside the production possibilities curve if they gain advantages by entering into international trade. I think you understood the two production possibilities curves we drew and then the two consumption possibilities curves we drew. Right. We will now move on to the question number 3. Table given below shows the number of labor hours required to produce one camera and a mobile phone in Singapore and China. Very carefully read the instruction given there. Table given below shows the number of labor hours required to. As I already told you, when this kind of table is given, the very first thing that you need to figure out is whether this is an input table or whether this is an output table. So, as I told you, if it is an output table, they should give us some number of units of output of the two products this economy can produce. Right? Some number of units of output this economy can produce by using this, using a certain amount of inputs. But if it is an input table, this is a very important thing, that inside that table you should identify some input units required to produce some number of units of output. The number of labor hours required to produce one unit, right? Or is the number of input units needed to produce some number of units of output, like that. So therefore, if you carefully read the question here, they give us the number of labor hours required to produce one camera and a mobile phone in the two countries. So as it gives us the number of labor hours required to produce a camera and a mobile phone, you should decide that this is an input table and not an output table, right? So we figured out that the given table is an input table first, right? We will now move on to the questions. Part A, which country has the absolute advantages for each product? Right, we will go back to the diagram, right? Which country has the absolute advantages in producing each product? So when an input table is given, the country which has the ability of producing the product at the lowest unit cost will have the absolute advantages on that respective product. So when China needs 20 labor hours to produce a camera, Singapore can produce a camera with 15 labor hours. Therefore, China has the ability of, sorry, not China, Singapore has the ability of producing a camera at the lowest unit cost. Therefore, Singapore will have the absolute advantages in producing cameras. Why is it? Singapore has the ability of producing a camera at the lowest unit cost when compared with China. Also, if you look at the number of labor hours required to produce a mobile phone, when China needs 30 labor hours to produce a mobile phone, right? Singapore needs only 20 labor hours to produce a mobile phone. So in that case, the lowest unit cost of producing a mobile phone is also there for Singapore. So you can see that the same country is having the absolute advantages for both products, cameras and the mobile phones. So this is actually the drawback of absolute advantages principle. The drawback of absolute advantages principle is the same country is having absolute advantages on producing both products. The same country is having absolute advantages on producing both products. So if the same country is having absolute advantages on producing both products, the absolute advantages principle does not provide a theoretical basis to enter into international trade. So at such a situation only, we are supposed to check with the comparative advantages and see whether the comparative advantages are distributed to the two countries. So under the comparative advantages, what we should do, we should calculate the opportunity cost of a unit of output of the two countries, and then the country with the lowest opportunity cost of producing that respective product will have the comparative advantages on that respective product. So we identified the answer for the first part. Singapore is having absolute advantages on producing cameras, and Singapore is having the absolute advantages on producing mobile phones as well. Right, we will go to the second question. We answered part A. Part B, which country possesses comparative advantages for each product? Which country possesses comparative advantages for each product? How do we calculate the comparative advantages? As I told you, under the comparative advantages, we should identify the country which has the lowest opportunity cost of producing each product. Right? And then there is a specialty in calculating the opportunity cost of an input table like this. Actually, there are two alternatives you have. One is you can convert this input table into an output table by using some number of labor hours. That is, here it gives us the number of labor hours required to produce one camera and a mobile phone. So you may choose some 100 labor hours and identify the number of cameras, the number of mobile phones each country can produce by using one labor hour. The other method that we can use to calculate the opportunity cost is, we can follow up the exact opposite method of calculating the opportunity cost for an output table. Right, we can follow up the exact opposite method of calculating the opportunity cost for an output table. PVC. Right, so we will calculate the opportunity cost of a camera in and a mobile phone in China. Right, so usually if it is an output table, it is mobile phones divided by cameras is the opportunity cost of a camera. But when it is an input table, I told you that we should use the exact opposite of it. That is, we should divide cameras by mobile phones. That is, 20 divided by 30 gives you the opportunity cost of 20 divided by 30 gives you the opportunity cost of a camera in China. So opportunity cost of a camera in China is 0.66 is the opportunity cost of a camera in China. I will separately calculate it. Divided by 30, 0.66 is the opportunity cost of a camera in China. And then we will calculate the opportunity cost of a mobile phone in China. Again, it should be 30 divided by 20 as it is an input table. We use MP for a mobile phone. So 30 divided by 20, opportunity cost of a camera, of a mobile phone in China is 1.5 cameras per mobile phone. And then we will calculate the opportunity cost of a camera and a mobile phone in Singapore, right? So again, it is cameras divided by mobile phones for a camera, and then mobile phones divided by cameras for a mobile phone, right? So therefore, Singapore is 15 divided by 20. The opportunity cost of a camera is 0.75. mobile phones per camera, and then opportunity cost of a mobile phone is 20 divided by 15. You will get it as 1.33 cameras per mobile phone. So like this we can calculate the opportunity cost of a camera and a mobile phone, and based on this calculation the lowest opportunity cost of a camera is therefore China, because when the opportunity cost of a camera in China is 0.66 mobile phones, the opportunity cost of a camera in Singapore is 0.75 mobile phones. Therefore the lowest opportunity cost of producing a camera is therefore China. And then the lowest opportunity cost of producing a mobile phone is therefore Singapore. Why is it? Compared with the opportunity cost of a mobile phone in the two countries, Singapore has the ability of producing a mobile phone at the lowest opportunity cost. So we can see here, now Singapore had the absolute advantages on producing both products, because Singapore could produce both products at the lowest unit cost when compared with the other country, China. But when we calculate the opportunity cost, we can realize here that the opportunity costs are lower for the two products to the two countries. Or in other words, the comparative advantages are distributed to the two countries. When China has the comparative advantages on producing cameras, Singapore will have the comparative advantages in producing mobile phones. Right, we will go for the next question. What is the mutually beneficial trade ratio between the two countries? What is the mutually beneficial trade ratio between the two countries? So what do we mean by the mutually beneficial trade ratio? Now China specializes in producing cameras, means what? China will allocate all the inputs that they hold to produce cameras, and China will not produce the other product, mobile phones. And then the other country, Singapore, will allocate all their resources on producing the product in which they have comparative advantages, that is to produce mobile phones, and Singapore will not produce any cameras. Afterwards, the two countries should exchange the two products at a certain ratio. There should be a certain ratio at which these two products are exchanged between the two countries. Whatever the ratio they are choosing to use should be a beneficial ratio for both the countries, right? Should be a beneficial ratio for both the countries. So we will try to identify the beneficial trade ratio for the two countries using each product. First of all, I will identify the beneficial trade ratio for one camera. Beneficial trade ratio for one camera. Beneficial trade ratio for one camera. Now, who specializes in producing cameras? China specializes in producing cameras. China specializes in producing cameras. China can produce a camera at the lowest opportunity cost when compared with Singapore. So, now China has to incur an opportunity cost of 0.66 mobile phones in order to produce a camera. After incurring such a cost on a camera, right, in order to exchange this with Singapore, for this exchange to be beneficial to the selling country, China should receive something more than the cost they incurred to produce it. If the selling country receives something more than the cost that they incurred to produce it only, the exchanging will be beneficial for the selling country. So the selling country incurs an opportunity cost of 0.66 mobile phones for a camera, no? So for this exchange to be beneficial from the selling country's point of view, the selling country, which is China, should receive more than 0.66 mobile phones per camera. Right? China should receive more than 0.66 mobile phones per camera. And then this trading should be beneficial from the buying country's point of view as well. This trading should be beneficial from the buying country's point of view as well. That is, the buying country here is Singapore, and the buying country, which is Singapore, should have to incur an opportunity cost of 0.75 mobile phones per camera. Singapore will incur an opportunity cost of 0.75 mobile phones per camera. So, what does it mean? If Singapore is producing a camera inside their country, they can produce a camera by using resources equivalent to 0.75 mobile phones. By using resources equivalent to 0.75 mobile phones. So, when they have the ability of producing a camera at such a cost, in order to buy a camera from China without producing a camera inside the country, Singapore should be able to purchase a camera at a lower unit cost from the other country than the cost that they have to incur to produce a camera inside their country. Now, Singapore has the ability of producing a camera at a cost of 0.75 mobile phones. So, without producing a camera inside the country, if this country is thinking of buying it from the other country, they should be able to purchase a camera at a lower price than the internal cost of production, which is 0.75 mobile phones per camera. Therefore, one camera should be exchanged with more than 0.66 mobile phones and less than 0.75 mobile phones. For an example, maybe some one camera equals to 0.7 mobile phones, right? 0.7 is a number which is more than 0.66 in one hand. On the other hand, 0.7 is a number which is less than 0.75 as well. So, like this, we have to identify the beneficial trade ratio for the two countries for a certain product. So, I identified it for one camera, and now we will try to identify it for one mobile phone as well. And now, the producing country of mobile phones is what? Singapore. Singapore is the country which can produce a mobile phone at the lowest opportunity cost. Singapore is the country which can produce a mobile phone at the lowest opportunity cost. Singapore is the country which can produce a mobile phone at the lowest opportunity cost. And Singapore has to incur an opportunity cost of 1.33 cameras per mobile phone. So, for this exchange to be beneficial from the selling country's point of view, the selling country, which is Singapore, should receive more than 1.33 cameras per mobile phone, then only the selling country will be beneficial through this trade. And then buying country of mobile phones is whom? China. China, as the buying country, has the ability of producing one mobile phone inside their country at an opportunity cost of 1.5 cameras. When China is having the ability of producing a mobile phone at the cost of 1.5 cameras, in order to buy it from Singapore without producing inside their country, the buying country, which is China, should be able to purchase a mobile phone at a price less than 1.5 cameras. Right? If the buying country can purchase the product at a lower price than the internal cost of production only, that country will find it beneficial to trade the product with the other country, to buy it from the other country. Therefore, one mobile phone should be exchanged with more than 1.33 cameras and should be exchanged with less than 1.5 cameras. Think you all understood the explanation. We will move on to the next question, question number 4. The table given below shows the details related to the cost of production of two countries X and Y, which produces the two goods, rice and garments. So, cost of production. So, this is an input table. The table gives us the number of inputs required to produce each product in each country, right? So, when country X can produce when country X needs 5 input units or the labor units to produce 1 unit of rice, country Y needs only 3 labor units to produce 1 unit of rice. Also, country X needs 2 labor units to produce 1 garment, whereas country Y needs 6 labor units to produce 1 garment. So, this is how we can interpret the given table, right? We will move on to the question. There are 3 subsections here as well. Section A, which country possesses absolute advantages in producing rice, right? So, the country which can produce a unit of rice at the lowest unit cost will have the absolute advantages on producing rice, no? When country X needs 5 labor units to produce a unit of rice, country Y needs only 3 labor units to produce a unit of rice. Therefore, country Y will have the absolute advantages in producing rice. Why? Country Y can produce a unit of rice at the lowest unit cost. Right. We will move on to the section B. Which country possesses the comparative advantages in producing garments? Which country possesses the comparative advantages in producing garments? So, in order to identify the country which has the comparative advantages in producing garments, you should calculate the opportunity cost of a unit of garment in the two countries. The country which has the ability of producing a unit of garment at the lowest opportunity cost will have the comparative advantages in producing garments. So again, this is an input table. So you should use the opposite method of calculating the opportunity cost of an output table to get the opportunity cost calculation done here, and based on that only you should identify the comparative advantages. Again, we are calculating the opportunity cost of one garment in the two countries. Opportunity cost of one garment in the two countries X and Y. Right. Country X and country Y. Look at this, please. Here, when it comes to the country X, they need 5 labor hours to produce a unit of rice. They need 2 labor hours to produce a unit of garment. So I told you that we should use the opposite method to calculate the opportunity cost for an input table when compared with the method used to calculate the opportunity cost for an output table. So the opportunity cost of a garment should be calculated by dividing 2 by 5, that is by dividing garments by rice. So 2 divided by 5. Is the opportunity cost of a unit of garment in the country X. So therefore it is 0.4 units of the rice, 4 units of rice, if we say 0.4 units of rice. Is the opportunity cost of a unit of garment in country X? Also, the opportunity cost of a unit of garment in country Y should be calculated by dividing 6 by 3, that is garments divided by rice. 6 divided by 3. Opportunity cost of a unit of garment in country Y is 2 units of garments. Right, 2 units of garments. So, based on this, the lowest opportunity cost of producing 1 unit of garment is therefore country X. Therefore, country X will have the comparative advantages on producing garments. The lowest opportunity cost of producing a garment is therefore country X. Therefore, country X will have the comparative advantages in producing garments. So, we answered that question. Part C, what should be the amount of garment units to be exchanged for 1 unit of rice to occur mutually beneficial trade between the two countries? What should be the amount of garment units to be exchanged for 1 unit of rice to occur mutually beneficial trade ratio trade between the two countries? In order to identify the amount of garment units that should be exchanged for 1 unit of rice for a mutually beneficial trade between the two countries, we should calculate the opportunity cost of a unit of rice in the two countries, country X and country Y. So, based on the table given, we will calculate the opportunity cost of a unit of rice between the two countries, rice, country X, country Y. So, opportunity cost of a unit of rice in country X should be calculated by dividing 5 by 2, and opportunity cost of a unit of rice in country Y should be calculated by dividing 3 by 6. So, 5 divided by 2, this one is 3 divided by 6. So, 5 divided by 2 is 2.5. and 3 divided by 6 is 0.5. Therefore, the lowest opportunity cost of producing a unit of rice is therefore country Y. So, country Y should specialize in producing rice. Actually, that is not needed to give the answer. We are supposed to identify the amount of garment units that should be exchanged for 1 unit of rice for a mutually beneficial trade between the two countries. So, we will say 1 unit of rice should be exchanged with more than the opportunity cost of producing country. Now, country Y has comparative advantages in producing rice. Therefore, country Y is the country which is producing rice. Right, so country Y has to incur an opportunity cost of 0.5 units of garments per unit of rice. So, after producing a unit of rice incurring an opportunity cost of 0.5 garments, they should receive something more than that to this trade to be beneficial for the selling country. Therefore, 1 unit of rice should be exchanged with more than 0.5 units of garments. Also, when you look at from the buying country's point of view, based on this calculation, the buying country of rice is the country X, right? The opportunity cost of producing a unit of rice in country X is 2.5 units of garments. What does it mean? The country X should incur an opportunity cost of 2.5 units of garments in order to produce a unit of rice. So, from country X point of view, when we see for the country X to purchase rice from the country Y without producing it inside their country, country X should be able to purchase a unit of rice at a lower cost than the internal opportunity cost. That is, country X should be able to purchase a unit of rice at a price less than 2.5 units of garments. Therefore, for the mutually beneficial trade to occur, one unit of rice should be exchanged with more than 0.5 units of garments and should be exchanged with less than 2.5 units of garments. I think understood this explanation. Right, we will move on to the question number 5. If the same country is having absolute advantages in producing both products, then the two countries being considered cannot enter into international trade. If the same country is having absolute advantages in producing both products, then the two countries being considered cannot enter into international trade. Do you agree with this statement? Explain your answer with a numerical example. Actually, I discussed this with you previously too. This is the drawback which we identify in relation to the absolute advantages principle. That is, if the same country is having the absolute advantages in producing both products, will the other country be able to get some benefit by entering into international trade? So we simply can't say that they cannot enter into the international trade. Why is it? We should calculate the opportunity cost of a unit of we should calculate the opportunity cost of one unit of this product in the two countries and should identify, right? We should calculate the opportunity cost of a unit of this product in the two countries and should identify which country has the ability of producing this respective product at the lowest opportunity cost, right? And if the comparative advantages are distributed to the two countries, then we can say the country is still the two countries can still enter into international trade based on the comparative advantages. So we will move on to the answer. Cannot agree with the statement. When the same country is having absolute advantages for both products, then the opportunity cost of producing each product in each country should be calculated and see whether the comparative advantages for the two products are distributed to the two countries. If the comparative advantages for the two products are distributed to the two countries, then the two countries can enter into international trade based on the comparative advantages. So we will see this with an example. Both the countries A and B can produce wheat and clothes. Following table shows the number of wheat units and cloth units which can be produced by each country using one unit of homogeneous composite unit of input. See this. When country A can produce 12 bushels of wheat by using one labor unit, country B can produce only 8 bushels of wheat, means country A has the absolute advantages in producing wheat. Also, when country A has the ability of producing 5 meters of cloth by using one labor unit, country B can produce only 2 meters of cloth by using one labor unit. What does it mean? Country A has the absolute advantages in producing both wheat and clothes, BVC. Country A possesses the absolute advantages for producing both goods. Country A possesses the absolute advantages for producing both goods. The country B faces for absolute disadvantages for both goods. Therefore, there is no opportunity for international trade based on the absolute advantages principle. So in order to see which country is having comparative advantages, we have to calculate the opportunity cost of each unit in the two countries. So we have to calculate the opportunity cost of a bushel of wheat in the two countries and the opportunity cost of a meter of clothes in the two countries. Right? This is an output table because it gives us the number of wheat bushels and cloth meters which can be produced by using one labor hour. Therefore, opportunity cost of a wheat unit of country A should be calculated by dividing quantity sacrificed from clothes by the quantity increased from wheat, that is dividing 5 by 12. And then opportunity cost of a unit of wheat in country B should be calculated by dividing the clothes sacrificed by the wheat increase, that is 2 by 8. So 5 by 12 and 2 by 8. Divided by 12, so it is 0.4. So the opportunity cost of a unit of wheat is 0.416 meters of clothes in country A. In country B, as we discussed, it is 2 divided by 8, it is 0.25. Here it is 12 divided by 5, which is 2.4. And here it is 8 divided by 2, which is 4. So based on this, the lowest opportunity cost of producing a unit of wheat or a bushel of wheat is therefore country B. Therefore, country B has the comparative advantages in producing wheat. And then the lowest opportunity cost of producing a meter of clothes is therefore country A. Therefore, country A will have the comparative advantages in producing clothes. So we can see that with this example that even when the same country is having absolute advantages on producing both products, we can't simply say that the two countries cannot enter into international trade. Right, maybe the two countries are arriving to the international trade based on the comparative advantages. If the comparative advantages are distributed to the two countries for those two products, then the countries can still enter into international trade. I think you understood this explanation. Question number 6. Following details are given in relation to the labor hours required to produce a television and a mobile phone in the two countries A and B. Further, each country is having 1000 labor hours respectively. So see, they have again given you the number of labor hours required to produce a television and a mobile phone. Right, number of labor hours required to produce a television and a mobile phone. So with this you need to understand that this is an input table because it gives us the number of labor hours required to produce each unit here. Right, so keeping this, we will move on to the question. First, which country is having comparative advantages for each product? The next question is to draw the consumption possibilities curve for each country if 50 televisions are traded at the ratio of 1 television for 1.5 mobile phones. First one, which country is having comparative advantages for each product. Second one, draw the consumption possibilities curve for each country. If 50 televisions are traded at the ratio of 1 television is for 1.5 mobile phones, right? We will go back to the previous. So this is an input table we discussed and we figured it out previously. So in order to identify the country which has the comparative advantages for each product, should calculate the opportunity cost. So we are supposed to use the opposite method of the usual method in doing this calculation. So the opportunity cost of a television should be calculated by dividing television by mobile phones, that is by dividing 10 by 8. Therefore, opportunity cost of a television is 1.25. Opportunity cost of a mobile phone is 0.8. Country B, 8 divided by 4, so it is 2. 4 divided by 8, so it is 0.5. On this basis, if you see, the opportunity cost of producing a television is the lowest opportunity cost of producing a television is therefore country A, when compared with the opportunity cost of a television in country B. Therefore, country A has comparative advantages in producing televisions, whereas the lowest opportunity cost of producing a mobile phone from the two countries is therefore country B. Therefore, country B will have the comparative advantages in producing mobile phones. So, therefore, again, country A has the comparative advantages in producing televisions, whereas the country B has the comparative advantages in producing mobile phones. So that is how we can identify the distribution of comparative advantages between the two countries. And now we are supposed to draw the consumption possibilities curve for the two countries. Before drawing the consumption possibilities curve, it would be better for us to draw the production possibilities curve. On that diagram itself, we can get the consumption possibilities curves of the two countries. That would be easier for us. And in this question, they say that each country is having 1,000 labor hours. Each country is having 1,000 labor hours. So we already calculated the opportunity cost and we identified that country A is having comparative advantages in producing televisions and country B is having comparative advantages in producing mobile phones. So now we have to get the information to draw the production possibilities curve. Like if 1,000 labor hours are there for country A and if they used it for producing televisions, they can produce 100 televisions. And without using that 1,000 labor hours on producing televisions, if they use that 1,000 labor hours on producing mobile phones, they can produce 125 mobile phones inside their country. They can produce 125 mobile phones inside their country. Country B, if they use the 1,000 labor hours they have on producing the televisions, on producing the televisions, country B has the ability of producing 125 televisions inside their country without using it for televisions. If country B uses it for producing mobile phones, country B has the ability of producing 250 mobile phones by using this 1,000 labor hours. So country A can produce 100 televisions or 125 mobile phones. Country B can produce 125 televisions or else 250 mobile phones. With that, we will draw the production possibilities curve for the two countries. Again, Country A can produce 100 televisions, 125 mobile phones. Country B can produce 125 mobile phones and 125 televisions and 250 mobile phones. So by joining these two, you can draw the production possibilities curve for country A. And country B, they can produce 125 televisions and 250 mobile phones. So 125 is the exact midpoint of it. Therefore, 250 mobile phones and 125 televisions. So this is the production possibilities curve for country B, and this is the production possibilities curve for country But we were supposed to draw the consumption possibilities curves of the two countries, and they gave us the exchange ratio for the two products as one television should be exchanged with 1.5 mobile phones and 50 televisions are exchanged. Based on the comparative advantages we calculated previously, we identified that the comparative advantages for the two products, we calculated it and we identified the country A is having comparative advantages on producing televisions and country B is having comparative advantages on producing mobile phones. Again, country A is having comparative advantages in producing mobile phones. Means what? Country A should specialize in producing televisions. Country A should specialize in producing televisions. Means what? Country A is now producing 100 televisions and the country A does not produce any mobile phones. Why is it? Country A specializes in producing televisions. No? Country A specializes in producing televisions, as Country A specializes in producing televisions, right? As Country A specializes in producing televisions, we identify that the Country A is producing 100 televisions and nothing from mobile phones. From these 100 televisions they produced, if they did not go for trade, that 100 televisions only they can consume even, and nothing of mobile phones can be consumed because they did not produce any mobile phones. But now they are trading 50 televisions, means they are trading 50, exporting 50 televisions to the other country, and in return they will get 75 mobile phones. If one television is traded with the mobile phones at 1.5 mobile phones, for 50 televisions they should get 75 mobile phones. So therefore this country will be able to consume 50 televisions and 75 mobile phones. Now this country will be able to consume 50 televisions and 75 mobile phones. Why is it, or how is it? They produced 100 televisions and from that they exported 50 to the other country. So there are 50 televisions for their consumption. And for the amount of televisions they exported, they are getting 75 mobile phones from the other country. So they will be able to consume 75 mobile phones now. So by joining these possible two consumption points, you can get the consumption possibilities curve for the two for the country A. And country B is specializing in producing mobile phones, and therefore they can produce 250 mobile phones, and even they can consume the same 250 mobile phones. They can consume the same 250 mobile phones. And afterwards they are offering 75 to the other country, so therefore 250 minus 75, they can consume only 175 mobile phones inside their country. And in return to the 75 mobile phones the country B is exporting to country A, they are receiving 50 televisions from country A. So therefore country B can consume 175 mobile phones and 50 televisions. This is their consumption point. So by joining these two points, you can get the consumption possibilities curve for the country. So therefore, country B is consuming 175 mobile phones and 125 televisions. This is how we draw the production consumption possibilities curves for the two countries. So we drew the consumption possibilities curve, and now we will move on to the question number 7, right? Let country A's endowment of labor equal 200 units and country B's endowment of labor equal 200 units. What does it simply say? The two countries are having 200 labor hours. The labor requirement for the production of 1 unit of good X and good Y in each country is given in the table below. Right? This is from 2018 A-levels. So labor units required to produce each product X and product Y are given in relation to country A and country B. Right. We will see what they expect from us. Draw separately production possibilities frontier for each country and label them correctly. Part B, which country has an absolute advantage in which good? Explain your answer. Which country has a comparative advantage in which good? Explain your answer. So we are supposed to draw the production possibilities curve for the two countries, and we are supposed to identify the absolute advantages for the two countries, and we are supposed to identify the comparative advantages for the two countries. Right, so see, the labor units required to produce a unit of X and a unit of Y for the two countries are given here. Good X, good Y, country A, country B. So we are supposed to draw the production possibilities curve, but before that they say that each country is having a labor stock of 200 units for the each country. So therefore, if this country allocate that 200 labor hours on producing the good X, right, if country allocates their 200 labor hours on producing the good X, they can produce 50 units of X. Instead of using it for producing X, if they use that 200 on producing the good Y, they can produce 50 units of Y, right? We identified the production capacity of country A now. They can either produce 40 units of X or else they can produce 50 units of Y. Country B, if they use their resource endowment on producing the good X, they can produce 50 units of X. Or else they can produce 25 units of Y. So we identified the production capacity of the two countries. The first part was to draw the production possibilities curves for the two countries. Country A can produce either 40 units of X or else 50 units of Y. 10, 20, 30, 40. Right, so by joining these two points, we can get the production possibilities curve of country A. We can draw the production possibilities curve for country A. And we will now draw the production possibilities curve for country B as well. Country B can produce either 50 units of X or else 25 units of Y. Right. like this we can draw the production possibilities curve for the two countries, country X and country A and country B. We drew the production possibilities curve for country A, right? Joining these two ends, and we drew the production possibilities curve for country B by joining these two points, right? So the next question was to identify the country for which there are absolute advantages for each product, right? Like actually now we have converted this input table into an output table now, so we can easily calculate and identify the absolute advantages as well as the comparative advantages by using the output table, or else by using the original input table itself we can identify both. So anyway, I will use the original information given by the question to identify the absolute advantages first. When country A needs 5 labor hours to produce a unit of X, they need only 4 labor hours to produce a unit of Y. And when country B needs 4 labor hours to produce a unit of X, they need only 8 labor hours to produce a unit of Y. So therefore, the lowest unit cost of producing a unit of X, when country A needs 5 labor hours to produce a unit of X, country B needs only 4 labor hours to produce a unit of X. Therefore, the lowest unit cost of producing 1 unit of X is therefore country B. Country B can produce a unit of X at the lowest opportunity cost. Therefore, absolute advantages in producing X is therefore country B. And then when country A needs 4 labor hours to produce a unit of Y, country B needs 8 labor hours to produce the same 1 unit of Y. Therefore, the lowest unit cost of producing a unit of Y is therefore country A. Therefore, country A will have the absolute advantages in producing the good Y. Again, country B is having absolute advantages in producing the good X, whereas country A is having absolute advantages in producing the good Y. Now we are supposed to calculate the comparative advantages. For that we need to get the opportunity cost. I'm using the input table here. As I told you, you can use the output table on the top as well. So as we are using the input table, the opportunity cost of a unit of X should be calculated by dividing 5 by 4. So it is 1.25. Opportunity cost of a unit of Y should be calculated by dividing 4 by 5, so it is 0.8. Also, the opportunity cost of a unit of X in country B should be calculated by dividing 4 by 8, so it is 0.5. Opportunity cost of a unit of Y in country B should be calculated by dividing 8 by 4, therefore it is 2. So based on these calculations, the lowest opportunity cost of a unit of X is therefore country B. So country B is having comparative advantages in producing the good X. Also, the lowest opportunity cost of producing a unit of Y is therefore country A. Therefore, country A will have the comparative advantages in producing the good Y. So this is how we can answer this question. Thank you all. Right. we will be moving to the next question from 2017 A-level. The following diagram shows production possibilities curves for country A and country B producing mobile phones and bicycles. Following diagram shows production possibilities curves for country A and country B producing mobile phones and bicycles. So the diagram is given here. We will move on to the questions. Part A, what is the opportunity cost of producing a bicycle in each country? The part B, which country has a comparative advantage in the production of mobile phones? Part C, for mutually beneficial trade to occur, what should be the rate of exchange between mobile phones and bicycles? For mutually beneficial trade to occur, what should be the rate of exchange between mobile phones and bicycles? Right, PVC. Part A, what is the opportunity cost of producing a bicycle in each country? So, in this kind of a situation, the best option is to prepare a small table that will be making you convenient to proceed with the calculations, right? So, country A can produce 1200 mobile phones or 400 bicycles, and country B can produce 600 mobile phones or 600 bicycles. Country A, country B, mobile phones, bicycles. Country A can produce either 1200 mobile phones or else 400 bicycles. Country B can produce 600 mobile phones or else 600 bicycles. Country A can produce 1200 mobile phones or else 400 bicycles. Country B can produce 600 mobile phones or else 600 bicycles. 600 mobile phones or else by using 600 bicycles they can produce, right? So, what we are supposed to do in the first part of the question is, we are supposed to identify the opportunity cost of producing a bicycle in each country. Opportunity cost of producing a bicycle in each country. So, in country A, one bicycle equals to, they have to sacrifice 400, they have to sacrifice 1200 mobile phones on behalf of 400 bicycles. So the opportunity cost of one bicycle in country A is 3 mobile phones. And then opportunity cost of a bicycle in country B is one bicycle again equals to country B has to sacrifice 600 mobile phones on behalf of 600 bicycles. Therefore, opportunity cost of a bicycle in country B is one mobile phone. So, we were supposed to calculate the opportunity cost of a bicycle in the two countries. So, in country A, one bicycle equals to 3 mobile phones, and in country B, one bicycle equals to 1 mobile phone. Part B, which country has a comparative advantage in the production of mobile phones? We are supposed to identify the comparative advantages for mobile phones that should be done by calculating the opportunity cost of a mobile phone in the two countries So in country A, one mobile phone equals to 400 bicycles are sacrificed on behalf of 1200 mobile phones. Therefore, opportunity cost of a mobile phone in country A is 0.33 bicycles. Also, one mobile phone can be produced by country B by sacrificing 600 mobile phones, sacrificing 600 bicycles on behalf of 600 mobile phones. So it is 600 divided by 600 is one bicycle. Right? So the opportunity cost of a bicycle, opportunity cost of a mobile phone in country A is 0.33 bicycles, and opportunity cost of a mobile phone in country B is one bicycle. So the lowest opportunity cost of producing a mobile phone is therefore country A. Therefore, country A will have the comparative advantages on producing mobile phones. Country A will have the comparative advantages on producing mobile phones. Why is it? Country A has the ability of producing a mobile phone at the lowest opportunity cost. Last one, for mutually beneficial trade to occur, what should be the rate of exchange between mobile phones and bicycles? You can either express it based on one mobile phone, or else you can express it based on one bicycle as well. So if you expressed it by using one mobile phone, actually we already discussed it in relation to a previous question, right? One mobile phone. Now, as we already discussed here, mobile phones are specialized by country A. The producing country has to incur an opportunity cost of 0.33 bicycles per mobile phone. So therefore, for the selling country to get a benefit by entering into international trade, they should receive more than 0.33 bicycles, per mobile phone. Right? One mobile phone should be exchanged with more than 0.33 bicycles. And it should be exchanged with less than one bicycle. Why is it? The buying country of mobile phones is country B. Country B can produce a mobile phone at the opportunity cost of one bicycle. So if that country B to purchase a mobile phone from country A without producing a mobile phone inside their country, that country should be able to purchase it at a lower cost than their internal cost of production. So therefore, one mobile phone should be exchanged with more than 0.33 bicycles and less than one bicycle. You can express the same in relation to a bicycle as well. That is, one bicycle should be exchanged with, I think you can remember, we already calculated the opportunity cost of a bicycle in two countries. It was three mobile phones in country A and one mobile phone in country B. Therefore, one bicycle should be exchanged with more than one mobile phone, which is the lowest opportunity cost, and less than three mobile phones, which was the higher opportunity cost, out of the opportunity cost calculations of the two countries. So this is how we can identify the mutually beneficial trade ratio between the two countries. One mobile phone should be exchanged with more than 0.33 bicycles and less than one bicycle. One bicycle should be exchanged with more than one mobile phone and less than three mobile phones. I think you understood the explanation. Right. Question number 9 is from 2010-11. The following table describes the number of meters of clothes and units of bicycles that can be produced with a week's worth of labor in Japan and in Korea. Assume that on the other no. So it should be no other inputs are needed. Assume that no other inputs are needed, right? So by using 1 week's worth of labor, Japan can either produce 12 meters of clothes or else 6 units of bicycles. Korea can either produce 8 meters of clothes or else 2 bicycles. Question 1. If there is no trade, what is the price of a bicycle in terms of clothes in Japan and Korea? In other words, in this question, they are asking us to identify the opportunity cost of a bicycle in the two countries. PVC. Japan and Korea. Japan and Korea, right? Opportunity cost of a bicycle in Japan should be calculated by dividing the quantity sacrificed from clothes by the quantity increased from bicycles, that is 12 divided by 6. 12 divided by 6. So opportunity cost of a bicycle in Japan is, better you say, one bicycle equals to 1 bicycle equals to 12 divided by 6, 2 meters of clothes, 2 meters of clothes. And Korea, 1 bicycle equals to 2. Korea has to sacrifice 8 meters of clothes on behalf of 2 bicycles, therefore 8 divided by 2, 4 meters of clothes is the price of a bicycle in Korea. That is how you should answer the part A. Part B, which country has the comparative advantage in the production of clothes? Explain your answer. So in order to identify the comparative advantages for clothes, you have to calculate the opportunity cost of a unit of clothes in Japan and Korea. Based on the answer what you get, only you can identify which country has the comparative advantages in producing clothes. So based on the table previously, Japan will have to sacrifice 12 bicycles on behalf of 6 meters of clothes. Therefore, opportunity cost of a meter of cloth in Japan is, we will say 1 meter of cloth, it would be better. It is 1 meter of cloth equals to 6 divided by 12, 0.5. bicycles. Opportunity cost of a meter of cloth in Korea is, we will simply say 1 cloth, again it is 1 meter of cloth, is 2 divided by 8, 0.25 bicycles. Right? Opportunity cost of a meter of cloth in Japan is 0.5 bicycles, and opportunity cost of a meter of cloth in Korea is 0.25 bicycles. Based on that, the lowest opportunity cost of producing a bicycle is therefore Korea. Therefore, you should say Korea has the comparative advantages in producing clothes. Korea has the comparative advantages in producing clothes. Therefore, part C, so we identified the comparative advantages for clothes as well. Part C, if two countries start trading with each other, which country will specialize and export which good? So, part C. Japan has the comparative advantage, the lowest opportunity cost of a bicycle is therefore Japan. No, the lowest opportunity cost for a bicycle is therefore Japan. Therefore, Japan should specialize in producing bicycles, whereas Korea should specialize in producing clothes and export clothes. Part D. What can be said about the rate of exchange at which trade will take place? We already discussed actually this, right? One bicycle should be exchanged with, we calculate the opportunity cost of a bicycle, no? In Japan it is 2 meters of clothes and in Korea it is 4 meters of clothes. It should be more than the lower opportunity cost out of the two opportunity cost calculations for the same product in two countries and less than the higher opportunity cost. The selling country should be able to sell the product at a higher value than their internal cost of production. The buying country should be able to buy the product at a lower cost than their internal cost of production. So therefore, one bicycle should be exchanged with more than 2 meters of clothes and less than 4 meters of clothes. Also, if you express the same in relation to clothes, 1 meter of clothes should be exchanged with more than 0.25 bicycles and less than 0.5 bicycles. Right, this is how we identify the mutually beneficial trade ratio between the two countries. Right, I think you understood the explanation. Right. Question number 10. The following table depicts the hypothetical production possibilities for country A and country B, each producing food and clothes. A. Assuming that there is a fixed opportunity cost in each country, complete the table. That's the first part of it. Draw the production possibility curves for the two countries on separate graphs. We are supposed to calculate the table, complete the table first, and then we are supposed to draw the production possibilities curves. Part C. If two countries are engaged in trade, which good does each country specialize in? Explain. So maybe by using absolute advantages, or else maybe by using comparative advantages, we should identify which country should specialize in which product. And there are two more questions. We will read the questions first before we move on to the answering. Part D. If 1 unit of food is traded for 1 unit of clothes, draw the consumption possibilities frontiers for each country on the graphs drawn by you. So we are supposed to draw the consumption possibilities curves as well. Last, before trade, assume that country A consumes 600 units of food and 200 units of clothes. After trade, how many units of clothes can be consumed by country A if it continues to consume 600 units of food? Right. So we will complete the table first. Right. So now you can see that if the opportunity cost is constant when the food production increases by 200 units at each stage, the cloth production decreases by 100, so therefore you simply need to take it by 100 by 100 downwards. So 300 here, 200 here, 100 here and 0 here. And when in relation to country B, when the food production increases by 100 units each, the cloth production decreases by 200 each. Therefore, this should be 400, 200, and 0. This is how you should complete the table, right? The cloth units will be 500, 400, 300, 200, 100, and 0. And then the cloth production in country B would be 800, 600, 400, 200, and then 0. So this is how we will be able to complete the table, and afterwards we were supposed to draw the production possibilities curve. So the ends would be, right, country A can produce 1000 units of food and then or else 500 meters of clothes. Country B can either produce 400 units of food or else 200 meters of clothes. The ends of the PPCs would be in this way. So we will draw the production possibilities curves of the two countries. Right, 100, 200, 300, 400, right? So we identified that the country A can either produce 1000 units of food or else 500 meters of clothes, right? So with that we can draw the production possibilities curve for country A. With that we can draw the production possibilities curve for country A by joining 1000 here and 500 here. This is the production possibilities curve for country A. And then we will draw the production possibilities curve for country B as well. Country B can either produce 400 units of food or else 800 meters of clothes, right? Country B again can either produce 400 food and 800 clothes. will be the production possibilities curve for the country B. So we drew the production possibilities curve for country A and the production possibilities curve for country B. We completed the table, we drew the production possibilities curve for the two countries. Part C, if the two countries are engaged in trade, which good does each country specialize in? Explain. Right? So, in order to identify the country in which country or product in which each country should specialize, we have to calculate the comparative advantages. So we will calculate the comparative advantages and see which country should specialize in each product. For country A, food, in order to produce 1000 units of food, they will have to sacrifice 500 clothes. So 500 divided by 1000 gives us the opportunity cost of a unit of food in country A, 0.5. Also, the opportunity cost of a unit of clothes in country A is they have to sacrifice 1000 food on behalf of 1000 food on behalf of 500 clothes. Therefore, 1000 divided by 500 is 2. Also, when it comes to the opportunity cost of a unit of food in country B, country B will have to sacrifice 800 meters of clothes on behalf of 400 food. So 800 divided by 400. Opportunity cost of a unit of food in country B is 2 meters of clothes or 2 units of clothes. Clothes in country B is they have to sacrifice 400 units of food on behalf of 800 meters of clothes. So therefore it is 0.5. Units of food is the opportunity cost of a unit of cloth in country B. Right? So now we will identify the comparative advantages, and based on that only we should identify the country which should specialize in each product. When the opportunity cost of a unit of food in country A is 0.5, the opportunity cost of a unit of food in country B is 2. So the lowest opportunity cost of producing a unit of food in country is there in country A. Therefore, country A will have the comparative advantages in food. So country A should specialize in producing food. Also, when the opportunity cost of a unit of clothes is 2 in country A, opportunity cost of a unit of clothes in country B is 0.5. So the lowest opportunity cost for clothes is therefore country B. Therefore, country B should specialize in producing clothes, right? So we identified that country A should specialize in producing food and country B should specialize in producing clothes. If 1 unit of food is traded for 1 unit of clothes, draw the consumption possibilities frontier for each country on the graphs drawn by you earlier. So now country A is specializing in producing food, means country A is producing 1000 units of food. Country A is producing 1000 units of food. Again, country A is specializing in food, and therefore they are producing 1000 units of food. The ratio of exchange is 1:1. So we can just assume some exchange, and based on that we can get another consumption point, and with that we can draw the consumption possibilities curve. So after producing 1000 units of food, right, after producing 1000 units of food, if they exchange 200, after producing 1000 units of food, if they sell 200 food units to the other country, then they can consume only 800 units of food, no? Right, then they can consume only 800 units of food. But in return, they will be getting another 200 cloth units from the other country. What does it mean? This country will be able to consume 800 food units and 200 cloth units. 800 food units and 200 cloth units. 200 food units are exchanged with 200 food units are exchanged with 200 cloth units. We just assumed a certain amount of exchange because they've given us the exchanging ratio. So this is that consumption point. So by joining these two, you can get the consumption possibilities curve for country A. You can get the consumption possibilities curve for country A. You can get the consumption possibilities curve for country A. Right, you can draw the consumption possibilities curve for country A. Now, country B is specialized in producing clothes, and therefore they are producing 800 units of clothes. Country B is specializing in producing clothes, and therefore they are producing 800 units of clothes. And if they also exchange 200 cloth units, they will be able to, after producing 800 cloth, if they export 200 cloth units to the other country, they can consume only 600 because they produced 800 and sell 600 to the other country. And from the other country, they are getting 200 food units. Means they can consume, being at this point, 200 food units and 600 cloth units. This is a possible consumption point for them. This is a possible consumption point for them. So by joining those possible consumption points, you can draw the consumption possibilities curve for country B. You can draw the consumption possibilities curve for country B. So this is how we can draw the consumption possibilities curves for the two countries. The last question: before trade, assume that country A consumed 600 units of food and 200 units of clothes. After trade, how many units of clothes can be consumed by country A if it continues to consume 600 units of food? Now we have the consumption possibilities curve. So if the country A wants to consume same 600 units of food, that would be one combination of consumption. They are consuming 600 units of food. So in order to identify how much of clothes can be consumed at this situation, what you should do, should come along with this 600 to the consumption possibilities curve until you meet the consumption possibilities curve, and should draw a line to the cloth axis. There you will see how much of clothes can be consumed by the same country when they are maintaining the consumption of food at 600. Anyway, after producing 1000 food, if they sell 400 to the other country, they will be getting 400 units of clothes on behalf of it, no? Because the rate of exchange is 1:1. Because the rate of exchange is 1:1. Right? So this is how we answer the last question. So we answered all 5 questions. Right, question number 11. The following are the labor requirements for a unit of output for 2 products in country A and country B. Which of the following is the most accurate statement? So we will see, what does the table say again? Following are the labor requirements. Labor requirements, what does it mean? They have given us the labor requirement, means what they have given us here is an input table. the labor requirement for a unit of bicycle and watch in the two countries A and B. So the unit cost of a bicycle in country A is unit cost of a bicycle in country A is 8 labor hours, whereas the unit cost of a bicycle in country B is 10 labor hours. So the lowest unit cost of producing bicycles is therefore country A. So the absolute advantages for producing bicycles is therefore country A. Also, the lowest unit cost of producing a watch is therefore country A. Therefore, the absolute advantages for producing watches is also therefore country A. So on this basis, the same country is having absolute advantages for producing both products. The same country is having absolute advantages for producing both products. Which of the following is the most accurate statement? PVC, part 1 or answer 1. Both countries can gain benefits according to the theory of absolute advantages. No, actually it is a wrong statement. Why is it? We cannot accept this. The reason is the same country is having absolute advantages on producing both products. So when the same country is having absolute advantages on producing both products, the other country will not gain benefits by entering into international trade based on the absolute advantages, right? So the first statement cannot be accepted. Right. We will see the next one. Trade will not take place between the two countries. We cannot exactly come into that conclusion without checking for comparative advantages. Right, we will calculate the comparative advantages also and try to identify which country is having comparative advantages for each product. Country A, country B. Bicycles, watches. Bicycles, watches, the unit costs are given in this way. This is an input table, so therefore 8 divided by 4, opportunity cost of a bicycle in country A, 4 divided by 8, opportunity cost of a watch in country A, right? 10 divided by 12, opportunity cost of a bicycle in country B, 0.8833. Here 12 divided by 10 is 1.2. So you can see the lowest opportunity cost for a bicycle is there in country B, and the lowest opportunity cost of a watch is there for country A. So the comparative advantages are distributed to the two countries for the two products. Therefore, second one is also wrong. It says trade will not take place between the two countries. No, they can enter into trade between based on comparative advantages. Third one, country A will have comparative advantages in producing bicycles. That is also wrong. Comparative advantages for country A is there for watches and not for bicycles. Right? What we are supposed to identify is the correct statement. 4. Country B will have comparative advantages in producing watches. Actually, that is also wrong. For watches, country A only will have the comparative advantages. 5. It is relatively beneficial for country B to export bicycles. Yes, it is. Why is it? country B only will have the comparative advantages in producing bicycles, no? When country B has the comparative advantages in producing bicycles, the entering into international trade based on this will be better for country B. That is, country B should export bicycles and should import watches. So that's what answer 5 says. It is relatively beneficial for country B to export bicycles and import watches. Yes, it is. Therefore, answer 5 should be the accurate statement for this question. So 5 should be accepted as the correct answer. We will move on to the next question number 12. The imported price of a pair of shoes traded in Sri Lanka is rupees 500. However, the domestic producers of Sri Lanka too produce the same pair of shoes by using imported materials worth of rupees 300. If the government imposes a tariff of 25% for an imported pair of shoes, what would be the effective rate of protection? Actually, the discussion we made up to this point was focusing on the theoretical approach to pro-international trade, the absolute advantages and comparative advantages. But this question is focused on a different topic, the effective rate of protection. The effective rate of protection identifies the percentage increase in the domestic value addition. The percentage increase in the domestic value addition due to the import duty system imposed by a government or simply by a country. So we are calculating the effective rate of protection by using the formula: the domestic value addition under the import duty system minus the domestic value addition under the free trade system divided by the domestic value addition under free trade system multiplied by 100. So we will see how to calculate the effective rate of protection based on this. The imported price of a pair of shoes traded in Sri Lanka is 500. However, the domestic producers of Sri Lanka too produce the same pair of shoes by using imported materials worth of 300. What does it mean? The domestic producers can produce a 500 rupee worth of a pair of shoes by using 300 rupees worth of imported raw materials. Means the domestic value addition when there is no import duty system is rupees 200. The domestic producer is producing a 500 rupee worth of a pair of shoes by using 300 rupee worth of imported raw materials. Means what? The domestic value addition under the free trade system is 200 rupees. The domestic shoe producers will be creating a domestic value addition of 200 rupees. Go back to the question. If the government imposes a tariff of 25% of an imported pair of shoes, what would be the effective rate of protection? Now the government imposes an import duty of 25%. Means what? The import duty is 125 plus the import cost is 500. The new import price of the product would be 625. New import price of the product would be 625. Right? Again, the new import price of the product will be 625. So the domestic producers are now producing a pair of shoes worth of 625 using imported raw materials of 300. The domestic producers are producing a pair of shoes worth of 625 using imported raw materials worth of 300. Therefore, the new domestic value addition is 325. Therefore, the new domestic value addition is 325. So the effective rate of protection is the domestic value addition under the import duty system minus domestic value addition under free trade system divided by domestic value addition under free trade system multiplied by 100. Therefore, it is 125 divided by 200 and multiplied by 100. So the effective rate of protection is 625. Effective rate of protection is, sorry, not 625, but 62.5 is the effective rate of protection here. Therefore, answer number 4, 62.5 is the answer for question number 12. Right. Question number 13. The table below shows the number of bicycles and tractors which can be produced with a composite resource unit in country A and country B. Right? Again, this is an output table. Why? They give us the number of bicycles and number of tractors they can produce by using one resource unit. Assume that each country specializes in the production in which it has a comparative advantage. For mutually beneficial trade to occur, the rate of exchange between tractors and bicycles should be right. So we are supposed to identify the mutually beneficial trade ratio between this information given here. So we will do the calculation and identify which country has the comparative advantage in each product. Again, the two countries are A and B, and tractors and bicycles. A, B, tractors, bicycles. Opportunity cost of a tractor. It is an output table, so 60 divided by 20 is 3. Here 10 divided by 2 is 5. Opportunity cost of a bicycle is 20 divided by 60 is 0.33. And here it is 2 divided by 10, so it is 0.5. So we calculated the opportunity cost. So based on that we can develop the trade ratio. One tractor should be exchanged with more than tractors and bicycles. One tractor should be exchanged with more than 3 bicycles and less than 5 bicycles. Also, one bicycle should be exchanged with more than 0.33 tractors and less than 0.5 tractors. So based on that we can go to the answers. Tractors, the exchange ratio between tractors and bicycles, less than 3 bicycles per tractor. Per tractor, it should be more than 3 bicycles and less than 5 bicycles. No, the first answer is wrong, therefore. Right, first answer is wrong, therefore. Second one, between 3 and 5 bicycles per tractor. Per tractor, between 3 and 5 bicycles, exactly yours. More than 3 bicycles and less than 5 bicycles per tractor. So the second answer is correct. We'll see the other answers. Between 2 and 60 bicycles per tractor, that is wrong. Per tractor, it should be between 3 and 5. 4, between 6 and 10 bicycles per tractor, that is also wrong, right? So therefore, second answer is the correct answer for this. Right, it should be between 3 and 5 bicycles per tractor. It should be between 3 and 5 bicycles per tractor. That is how you should identify the answer for this question. Question number 14. Following table represents the number of labor hours required by Sri Lanka and India to produce 1 unit of tea and 1 unit of cloth. Again, they have given us the input an input table here because they are giving us the number of labor hours to required to produce clothes and tea. Find the correct statement related to production possibility of two countries. So again, if you see, Sri Lanka needs 8 labor hours to produce a unit of clothes, whereas India needs only 6 labor hours. The lowest unit cost of producing clothes is therefore India. Therefore, India has absolute advantages in producing clothes. Also, when Sri Lanka needs 5 labor hours to produce a unit of tea, India needs only 2 labor hours to produce a unit of tea. So, the lowest unit cost of producing a unit of tea is also therefore India. Therefore, India will have the absolute advantages in producing both clothes and tea. First answer, Sri Lanka has the absolute advantage in both goods. That is wrong. India only has the absolute advantages for producing both products. Opportunity cost of producing one unit of tea in India is 3 units of clothes. We will calculate it. This is an input table, therefore 8 divided by 5 is 5 divided by 8. Sorry, 6 divided by 2. Opportunity cost is 3 here. 2 divided by 6. Opportunity cost is 0.33 here. So based on this, the lowest opportunity cost for a cloth unit is Sri Lanka, and the lowest opportunity cost for a tea unit is therefore India. So we will go to the second answer. Opportunity cost of producing one unit of tea in India is 3 units of clothes. Yes, it is. Opportunity cost of producing one unit of tea in India is 3 units of clothes is wrong, because it is 0.33. The second answer is also wrong. Therefore, India has the comparative advantage in tea production. India has the comparative advantage in tea production. Actually, the third answer is correct. We will check with other answers as well. Both countries can take the advantage of international trade according to the theory of absolute advantage. No, it is wrong, because the same country is having absolute advantages for both products. 5. Sri Lanka has the absolute advantage in clothes production. Wrong, we already discussed it. Therefore, answer number 3 should be taken as the answer for question number. Answer number 3 should be taken as the answer here. Right. We will now move on to the next question. 5. According to the principle of comparative advantage, worldwide output and consumption levels will be highest when goods are produced in countries where which of the following is true? As we already discussed, along with the comparative advantages, we are talking about the opportunity cost. So the country with the lowest opportunity cost will have the comparative advantage on that product. So according to the comparative advantages principle, we say that the country with the lowest opportunity cost should specialize in that respective product and should enter into international trade. Therefore, answer number 1 is the answer for question number 15. Question number 16. In country A, it takes 5 labor hours to produce 1 unit of clothes and 10 labor hours to produce 1 unit of rice. So the best thing is to get this into a table. Country A, the two products we are talking about are, in country A, it takes 5 labor hours to produce 1 unit of clothes and 10 labor hours to produce 1 unit of rice. Clothes 5 labor hours, 10 labor hours. In country B, it takes 7 labor hours to produce 1 unit of cloth and 21 labor hours to produce 1 unit of rice. 7 and 21. Right? If the two countries have decided to specialize according to each country's comparative advantage, at what exchange rate would the country A be willing to trade with country B? So for that we have to calculate the opportunity cost, and based on that we should get into the answer. So we again see they are talking about the number of labor hours, so this is an input table, so we have to calculate the opportunity cost here by dividing 5 by 10, 0.5, and here it should be 10 divided by 5, so it's 2. Here it should be 7 divided by 21, 0.33, and here it should be 21 divided by 7, so exactly 3. So based on this we can say one cloth unit should be exchanged with more than 0.33 rice and less than 0.5 rice. Also, one rice should be exchanged with more than 2 cloths and less than 3 cloths. Right. More than 2 units of cloth per unit of rice. Per unit of rice, more than 2 cloth units and less than 3 cloth units. No. If you read the question once again. If the two countries have decided to specialize according to the each country's comparative advantage, at what exchange rate would the country A be willing to trade with the country B? Right? Country A is only, the question is talking only about country A. A very good question this is. Country A would be willing to trade with country B. Right? This question is only from, they look at only from country A's point of view. Right? See again the question. This is from actually 2020 A level. At what exchange rate would the country A be willing to trade with country B? Right? So now country A is, we will identify the comparative advantages also. 0.33 is less here and 2 is less here. Right? Country B is having comparative advantages for clothes and country A is having comparative advantages for rice. Again the question, at what exchange rate would the country A be willing to trade with B? More than 2 units of clothes per unit of rice. Now according to this, for rice the comparative advantages are there for country A, no? The lowest opportunity cost. Right? So who produces rice now? Right? Who produces rice now? Country A only produces rice. Country A only produces rice. And country A has to incur an opportunity cost of 2 cloth units in producing 1 unit of rice. Country A has to incur an opportunity cost of 2 units of clothes in order to produce 1 unit of rice. So after producing a unit of rice, using resources equivalent to 2 units of clothes, right? The country A is producing 1 unit of rice using resources equivalent to 2 units of clothes. Resources equivalent to 2 units of clothes. So if they are receiving more than 2 units of clothes per unit of rice, it will be beneficial for them, right? Whether that is beneficial for the other country or not is not a material thing for country A, no? When we are identifying the mutually beneficial trade ratio, we should look at from both countries' point of view. That is true. But when the question is focusing only on one country, and if we have to look at from that country's point of view, right? If they are receiving something more than their internal cost of production, they should definitely go for exchange. Therefore, country A is expecting more than 2 cloth units for a unit of rice. So, first answer itself is correct, more than 2 units of cloth per unit of rice. Right? More than 2 units of rice per unit of cloth is wrong. More than 3 units of cloth per unit of rice is wrong. More than 3 units of rice, all these are wrong. So, the answer number 1 should be taken as the answer here. More than 2 units of clothes per unit of rice. Next question. Which two of the following arguments are most likely to be used to justify protectionism? So, what do we mean by the protectionism policies? Any step taken by the government to restrict free international trade, any step taken by the government to restrict free international trade is identified as a protectionism policy. So, both the tariff barriers as well as the non-tariff barriers are used by a government to implement the protectionism policies. So, in order to protect the strategic industries which are important for the national security of a country, in order to protect the infant industries from the international large-scale competitors, in order to prevent from dumping, in order to generate an income to the government, right? And then in order to increase the domestic level of employment, the government of a country may be following up the protectionism policies. So, therefore, to protect high-cost domestic industries, we will see the answers. Which of the following two arguments are most likely to be used to justify protectionism? To protect strategically important industries, it is very exactly correct. Right, it is exactly a reason. To protect infant industries, very exactly yes. To protect environmental standards, we cannot very exactly say it so. Right, to maximize government tax revenue, even though yes, actually it is a reason to protectionism. Through protectionism, the government may be expecting to generate an income, but like the most valid arguments are to protect the valid, strategically important industries, to protect infant industries. We can't say to protect high-cost domestic industries, so that will not promote the efficiency and all. So, therefore, that cannot be taken into consideration. To protect environmental standard is not the only like reason or a major reason, but to protect strategically important industries and to protect infant industries from the international large-scale competitors, a country is implementing the protectionism policies. Therefore, B and C can be taken as the answer here. Question number 18. The table below shows the ability of the country X and country Y to produce rice and coffee when they use all of their resources for that product. So, ability means they have given us an output table here. What is the correct statement regarding the cost advantage of the two countries? Based on this, we will see rice and coffee and X and Y. Rice, coffee, the two countries X and Y. So we will calculate the opportunity cost also. It would be easier for us to do the calculation. So it is an output table. So therefore, 5,000 divided by 5,000 is 1. 5,000 divided by 10,000 is 0.5. 5,000 divided by 5,000 is 1 again, and 10,000 divided by 5,000 is 2. Right, so the lowest opportunity cost of producing a unit of rice is therefore country Y, and the lowest opportunity cost of producing a unit of coffee is therefore country X. Right. You are supposed to identify the correct statement now based on this. Country X has a comparative advantage in the production of rice. Wrong. For comparative advantages, country Y only holds comparative advantages for rice. 2. Country X has a comparative advantage in the production of coffee. Exactly yes, country X only has comparative advantages on producing coffee. Therefore, country X has the comparative advantages in producing coffee. Therefore, the answer number 2 is the correct answer here. Country X has a comparative advantage in the production of coffee. Question number 19. A country's terms of trade increased from base year value of 100 to 130 in the following year. What changes in export prices and import prices would have caused this? The base year values of export price index as well as the import price index are the same in every year, right? So what do they say? The base year value of export price index and import price index should always be 100. So the terms of trade is also 100. We know that terms of trade is calculated by using the formula export price index divided by import price index multiplied by 100. Export price index divided by import price index multiplied by 100 is the formula for terms of trade. So the terms of trade of the base year is 100. Now the question says, in the current year, the terms of trade increases to 100 to 130 by 30%. Right? They want us to identify the reason for this. Export price index decreased by 30%. Import price index increased by 10%. Export price index decreased by 30%, import price index increased by 10%. This decreases by 30% and this increases by 10%. So decreasing export price index leads for the terms of trade to go down, and if import price index increases, that is also leading for the terms of trade to go down. So definitely the terms of trade of the economy will be going down as a result of it, not that it goes up. Therefore, the first answer should be definitely rejected. Second answer, export price index decreases, the import price index decreases. So when export price index decreases, terms of trade decrease by 20%. Import price index decreases by 10% means that is supporting for the terms of trade to increase by 10%. But the net figure of those two is just 10%. It will not go up by 30%. But in this question, they are talking about a 30% increase in the terms of trade. Going up from 100 to 130 means terms of trade increases by 30%. Third answer, increased by 30%. And import price index remain unchanged. If the export price index increases by 30%, the new value should be 130. 100 to 130. Import price index remains unchanged means in the base year it is 100, in the current year is also it is 100. The two hundreds are setting off with each other, so the terms of trade would be 130. So therefore, the third answer is identifying the exact reason for this. The export price index increases by 30% and then the import price index remains unchanged. So we should identify the third answer as the answer for this question. Right, question number 20. In Japan, it takes 50 labor hours to produce 1 unit of cloth and 100 labor hours to produce 1 unit of rice. Right, we'll write it down. Japan quotes rice. Right, 50 labor hours to produce a unit of cloth, 100 labor hours to produce a unit of rice. Right. In Thailand, it takes 200 labor hours to produce 1 unit of cloth and 200 labor hours to produce 1 unit of rice. So in Thailand, 200 labor hours to produce a unit of cloth, 200 labor hours to produce a unit of rice. So we will calculate the opportunity cost. Cloth, rice. Japan, 50 divided by 100, because it is an input table, 0.5. Here it is 100 divided by 50, so it is 2. This one, 200 divided by 200 is exactly 1, and 200 divided by 200 is exactly 1. So the lowest opportunity cost of producing a unit of cloth is therefore Japan. So therefore Japan has comparative advantages in producing clothes. Lowest opportunity cost of producing a unit of rice is therefore Thailand. So Thailand has comparative advantages in producing rice. Japan has a comparative advantage in the production of rice, that is wrong. For production of rice, Thailand only has comparative advantages. Second, Thailand has an absolute advantage in the production of rice, that is wrong. The lowest unit cost of producing both clothes and rice is therefore Japan. Right. Next answer. Japan has a comparative advantage in the production of clothes. Here it is, based on this calculation, Japan only has the comparative advantages in producing clothes. On that basis, the answer should be the third answer for the question number 20. 21. Which of the following is correct for a country that does not have an absolute advantage in producing any good or a service? So we already discussed that if a certain country does not have absolute advantages on any of the two products, right, we should check for comparative advantages. Most probably the comparative advantages will be distributed between the two countries, so they should enter into international trade based on the comparative advantages. So therefore, we have to check with comparative advantages now. Therefore, it will have a comparative advantage in the production of the good or the service in which it has the lowest opportunity cost, and we should enter into the international trade based on the comparative advantages. Therefore, we should accept the second answer. Consider the following table. Export price index decreases now, see, from 100 to 90, right, 90 to 80. Now, if you carefully see here, when the export price index decreases by 10%, when the export price index decreases by 10%, the terms of trade decreases by 20%, something more than that. When the export price index, now we already discussed the equation. Equation for terms of trade is export price index divided by import price index multiplied by 100. So if only the export price index decreases by 10% and nothing happens to the import price index, the terms of trade of this economy should go down by 10%. But according to this presentation, when the export price index decreases by 10%, when the export price index decreases by 10%, the terms of trade decreases by something more than that. Export price index decreases only by 10%. The terms of trade decreases by 20%. What does it mean? Not only the export price index is supporting for this decrease in the terms of trade here, but also the import price index is also supporting for the terms of trade to go down. The import price index is also supporting for the terms of trade to go down. Right? So, under what circumstances the import price index is supporting for the terms of trade to go down? If the import price index is going down only, if the import price index is going up only, because the terms of trade is export price index divided by import price index multiplied by 100. So, if the import price index is going up only, the terms of trade is decreasing. So, therefore, the second answer should be taken as the answer here. Import prices were rising. So, when the import prices are rising, only the terms of trade is going down in relation to the import price index. Because according to this, export price index is supporting for the terms of trade to decrease, and at the same time the import price index is also supporting for the terms of trade to go down. So that can happen if the import prices were rising on. Which of the following statements is statements about comparative advantage is correct? PVC. Comparative advantage is based solely on differences in climate. It is true that the differences in climate is a reason for the comparative advantages. But can we say that it is the only reason? No, we can't. Therefore, the first answer is wrong. Second, comparative advantage is based solely on differences in factor endowment. It is true that the factor endowment is a reason for comparative advantages, but you can't say that it is the only reason. Therefore, we should reject the second answer as well. Third, to have a comparative advantage, a country must also have an absolute advantage. We already discussed with few presentations even previously. That is wrong. For a country with a rising price level will lose any existing comparative advantages. Again, no. We did not identify, or we do not identify, the price level as a reason for the comparative advantages. Last, a comparative advantage for certain products may be created by prudential policies of the government. Yes, it is. This is one reason for comparative advantage. So we should select the fifth answer here. Right. 24. The table below shows the number of goods X and Y which two countries A and B produce using a composite resource unit. Assume that each country specializes in the product in which it has a comparative advantage. The rate of exchange suitable for each country to gain from trade would be. So we will calculate the comparative advantages. This is an output table. So therefore, country A, country B, right? So this is 200 divided by 100. Opportunity cost is 2. Here 100 divided by 200, opportunity cost is 0.5. Here 400 divided by 300, opportunity cost is 1.33. 300 divided by 400, opportunity cost is 0.75. Right, in relation, all the answers here are given in relation to 1 minute of XNOF. All the answers given here are identified in relation to 1 minute of X. So based on this calculation, opportunity cost of a unit of X in the country A is 2 here, country B is 1.33 here. What does it mean? 1 unit of X should be traded with more than 1.33y and less than 2y. 1 unit of X should be traded with more than 1.33y and less than 2y. What does it mean? Any answer which is identifying a ratio between these two should be your answer. Any answer which is identifying a ratio between these two, more than 1.33, less than 2. 1x equals to 1y is not in that range. 1x equals to 1.33, 1.33 is less than, 1.3 is less than 1.33. 1x equals to 1.5 is in between these two. No? Therefore, this should be taken as the answer, because 1.5 is in between these two figures. Right. Thank you, understood. The country's terms of trade currently stands at 150. Since 2010, the base year is 2010. Right, base year is 2010. So in 2010, export price index should be 100, import price index should be 100, the terms of trade should be 100. Now in the current year, right, the country's terms of trade currently stands at 150. So the current year value is, this one is given as 150. Since 2010, the average price the country has received for its exports has increased by 20%. They say that this term export price index has gone up by 20%. Means this value should be 120. 20% of 100 is 20, so 100 plus 20 is 120. Right? Thus, the average price it has paid for import should have changed by. They are asking by how much the import prices should have changed. Actually, the question they are asking by how much this has been changed. Right? We will see. So terms of trade is equal to export price index divided by import price index multiplied by 100. Terms of trade is 150. Export price index is 120. Import price index is not known, multiplied by 100. So 150 equals to 12,000 divided by X. Therefore, X equals to 12,000 divided by 150. Right. Import price index should be how much? 80. what does it mean? The import price index has decreased by 20% because it has gone down from 100 to 80. Import price index has decreased by 20% because it has gone down from 100 to 80. Therefore, answer number 3 should be taken as the answer for question number 25. The import price index has gone down by 20%. So with the today's discussions, we were focusing on the 9th lesson of the syllabus, international trade. So we gave the attention on the absolute advantages principle, comparative advantages principle, the terms of trade, the effective rate of protection. I think you all got a good understanding regarding the applications of this lesson, right? With the expectation of meeting with another seminar focusing on the exam, advanced level examination, we will meet in the next day. Again, I'm thanking to the Bank of Ceylon for giving me this great opportunity for this social responsibility program of Nanajaya. So we will meet in the next day, and thank you very much.